Gary Rosen, host of Unanimous Sunday Night. I'm the director of the Asian Research Center. And it's my very great pleasure today to welcome Professor Jacqui True, who's going to be presenting the seminar for you. Jacqui is the director of the Monash University Gender, Peace and Security Center, and also Professor of Politics and International Relations. Professor True received a PhD from the University in Toronto. She's held academic positions at Michigan State University, the University of Southern California, and the University of Auckland. Professor True has also held visiting positions at the Australian National University and at Gothenburg in Sweden. She is the author of 13 books and over 100 articles and book chapters on gender and international relations, feminist methodologies, international political economy, and women, peace and security. Her 2012 book, The Political Economy of Violence Against Women, published by Oxford University Press, is very, very widely acclaimed. It swept awards internationally and nationally, winning the American Political Science Association's 2012 Biennial Prize for the Best Book in Human Rights, the British International Studies Association International Political Economy Book Prize in 2013, and the Australian Political Science Association's Carol Pateman Prize for Gender and Politics in 2015. Professor True's current research is focused on understanding the political economy of post-conflict violence against women, the patterns of systemic sexual and gender-based violence in Asia-Pacific conflict-afflicted countries, the role of women in the prevention of violent extremism, and the impact of inclusive peace processes and agreements on women's post-conflict participation. This ambitious and important work is funded by the Australian Research Council and the Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade. Not surprisingly, given all of those points that I've made, in 2015, Professor True was elected a Fellow of the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia. An acknowledgement among her peers of her internationally reputed research and outstanding intellectual leadership and collegiality. It's thus a very great pleasure now to hand over to Jacqui, who will speak today on the topic, the political economy of women's post-colonial participation.
Thanks so much, Gary. That's a really nice introduction, very generous of you. It's great to be visiting Murdoch and to see quite a few familiar faces, so thank you so much for the invitation. I'm really pleased to be here. So today I want to speak about, as Gary said, the political economy of women's post-conflict participation. And I'm going to sort of, this relates to my future fellowship project, so it's very much work in progress. But I start from this kind of basic question: how can we understand women's post-conflict participation or the lack thereof? And relatedly, why are so women so often absent or excluded from the construction of peace and peace agreements and marginalised with respect to their social and economic status and rights after conflict? And I want to kind of explore and start from the premise, I mean, a lot of literature in the political science realm has kind of assumed that post-conflict is a kind of an opportunity for social rupture or for transforming social relations and rebuilding societies in more equal and seemingly humane ways. And in particular, also an opportunity for reinventing gender roles. And today, although I did want to present an Asian case, I've done most work so to date on Bosnia and Herzegovina, and that's a very significant case, I think, for testing this social rupture hypothesis. Because it was a conflict more than 20 years ago, in which the West and the international community felt they were really successful in brokering sort of what I'll talk about as the liberal peace. But I want to say that I have been doing research on Sri Lanka, also Myanmar, and so I'll be really happy to talk about, and to engage with you in discussions about how this framework potentially applies to Asia. I think with respect to Bosnia, it's really important to look beyond numbers and numbers of women in political life after conflict in terms of, kind of new regime, new political institutions and to look at the politics of economic reform and the impacts that they are having on women and men after conflict. And also, I think Bosnia here is also really significant because it was the conflict that really put the issue of sexual and gender-based violence as a weapon of war onto the international agenda, and made, and the testimonies from especially Bosnian Muslim women were really significant in making rape and other sexual violence a war crime, a crime against humanity and a crime of genocide under the 1998 Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court. So it's very significant in all of those ways. And just to kind of not to hold you in suspense, in terms of how I might begin to answer that question, how can we understand women's post-conflict participation or the lack thereof? My argument is that the answer to that lies in a broader feminist political economy analysis of the gendered structural inequalities that underlie conflict and that are frequently restored and exacerbated after conflict. So post-conflict peace may not look inclusive or equal or more humane from a gender perspective. So I want to introduce that core concept of participation. I'm sure many of you in your own work are kind of engaging that concept. And just to, sort of a really obvious point, sort of thing that we raise with our students in undergraduate lectures, that participation from a political economy perspective does not just involve political representation, or merely the presence of actors in things like peace negotiations or constitutional dialogues and so on. And this aspect of participation at present is very much the focus of the United Nations Women, Peace and Security Agenda. But I really want to focus on economic and social participation in post-conflict relief and recovery, as those are really important dimensions. But they're important dimensions from a political economy perspective because what we know is that economic inequality and social inequality lies at the basis of political inequality. And that the concentration of power is a result of also the concentration of resources, and that that the power in particular groups' hands also kind of shapes political outcomes. And I would also argue it also shapes the likelihood of the recurrence of violence and conflict. And as we know from the World Bank report on conflict and development in 2011, currently, 90% of the conflicts that we have in the world, especially for civil wars, are in countries that already had a civil war in the past. So there is a kind of a cycle of conflict, poverty, inequality that goes on, and it's difficult to see how to break it. So I just, although it's definitely a scholarly project, I very much situate my work and this research in the context of the United Nations Women, Peace and Security Agenda. Which began with the Resolution 1325 by the Security Council in 2000, and is now a slew of 8 resolutions from the Security Council around 4 pillars that's come to be coined 4 pillars, certainly after 2004 and the UN Secretary General's denoting of these pillars. So they are the notion that conflict is differently experienced by women and men, and that matters in terms of how we respond to conflict, how we prevent it. And so the pillars are really around the need to recognise women's specific roles in the prevention of conflict, and especially focused on the kind of roles that they have, the local community level, already preventing conflicts. You think of many African contexts. I think Burundi is a great case where sort of 500 conflicts were prevented by women, local women leaders last year alone. So a lot of these prevention activities go under the radar until we have this Women, Peace and Security Agenda. The protection pillar, which is also about the kind of human rights violations and the harms that are actually quite gender specific. They actually affect women and men differently, and they are different. So particularly bringing into the security agenda and security policy making this the way in which sexualized and gender-based violence become sort of weapons of war or actually forms of violence that are used for political and reasons to carry on the conflict. And then we have the participation pillar, which is around the right to equal participation in peace and security processes, decision-making, and that would also include after conflict. And the fourth pillar is this one about relief and recovery, and that's, you know, very much oriented toward post-conflict, toward the sustainability of peace, and the remaking of societies. And what I argue is this is completely underdeveloped in this agenda, and more generally, in the context of Security Council cross-cutting agendas. I also like to think of the fourth pillar as sort of really speaking directly to the political economy of post-conflict. So, and what I argue with respect to the Bosnian case, and what I'm going to argue, is that we must take the political economy of post-conflict seriously if we are actually concerned with all of those pillars. If we're concerned with women's equal participation with men and peace and security, if we're concerned with gender-specific protection, civilian protection of civilians, men, women, girls and boys, and if we are concerned with the prevention of conflict, which is currently a massive focus and a massive failure of global governance institutions, including the UN. So I also just, I'm going to come back to this, but this is of course an image of the Dayton Peace Accord. And at that point in 1995, there was no international political discourse about women being at the peace table. It was all war, and this had consequences, but I'll say a bit more about that in a minute. And I just wanted to say that what I'm doing here actually builds on the work I've previously done, and just in the book Gary mentioned, Political Economy of Violence Against Women, here the argument is that gendered structural inequalities underlie and fuel conflict, and that they're exacerbated in peacetime. So we already know that gendered identity is kind of part of what mobilises people for war, mobilises men to protect, often women and children, the homeland, the motherland, and we know that it is also gendered identities that make sexualised and gender-based violence so effective as a strategy in shaming and stigmatising and oppressing, because there is a pervasive silence about that type of violence and a whole range of issues around men's honour, in protecting women as property. But also I think we can see how, if we look at conflict, we can also see how the effects of it are really also gender disaggregated, in the sense that although men typically are the majority of those killed in war, in terms of indirect war deaths through displacement and disease, actually female deaths are, you know, kind of equivalent to male deaths. And then we also look at the gendered poverty that ensues after conflict in terms of the disproportionate number of female-headed households and the oppressions and the challenges that they have in accessing resources, employment, land, all of the education, expose them to further inequality and violence. And actually there's a number of studies that actually do talk about a spike in sexual gender-based violence after conflict. So, it makes for quite depressing reading. I'm sure my husband always says, I can't believe you can work on such depressing stuff. But I would like to, I think there are some hopeful things here. And I also want to build here on, the work I've done with Aida Hozic and a number of other feminist political economists to look at the scandalous economics of post-conflict. So I think there's three things about post-conflict which make the economic reforms often scandalous, often don't even need a scandal to obfuscate what's going on. But first of all, in this book, we show how financial crises, but these can also be security or conflict crises, enable extraordinary responses. So a lot of things can happen when there's not a rule of law in place, right? A lot of things can happen in that extraordinary time. Secondly, austerity programs of structural reform that restore power and order after conflict tend to also obfuscate the material causes and consequences of conflict. You know, really are not cognizant of the ways in which they may be actually sort of exacerbating some of the actual key drivers of conflict. And they also often co-opt the language of inclusion. Inclusive peace seems to be, really very much the language of the time, without actually recognising the exclusionary impacts of these kinds of economic reforms. And thirdly, we also can see in the post-conflict period that that we also have, together with this sort of road to market freedom, also militarisation. and that there's an increased power of the coercive state to deliver law and order in hand with post-conflict recovery. So think here of Naomi Klein's work on shock doctrine, disaster capitalism. All of these things can happen in these moments. And so that's kind of the next project for AIDA and I. Let's get through that one. So I already referred to the Women, Peace and Security Agenda, the underdevelopment of relief and recovery. And here, I mean, there's in 2015, there was a study done on the implementation of Resolution 1325 on Women, Peace and Security, which does, you know, note the importance of economic recovery programs, but in a kind of a piecemeal way. And actually, if we actually look at, for example, the kinds of aid or donor spending on this area, we can see that in 2013, in terms of the cash that went for economic recovery to post-conflict affected and fragile states, 22% was dispersed to women directly and the remainder to men. And that currently just 2% of aid internationally to fragile conflict affected states is tagged to address gender inequalities. Okay, so let me just, with that background, let me turn now to the Bosnian case. Okay, so just a few pictures I took, it was in Bosnia the last 2 years. So as I mentioned, this is a movie that I'm calling The Ghost that really spoke about, the estimated, 250,000 rapes that were committed during the Yugoslavian war. 15 years later, we also have another movie, if you haven't seen it, The Whistleblower, and that revealed the highly gendered nature of the peacekeeping economy in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And it told the story of the egregious abuse, enslavement and violence perpetrated by UN peacekeeping forces in Bosnia through a trafficking network that was spurred by officials, privately contracted UN peacekeepers. The girls and women were trafficked from Moldova and Ukraine and former Eastern Europe. And it was the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, now Secretary General Madeleine Reeves, who in the film is played by Vanessa Redgrave. She was the UN human rights lawyer in Bosnia who supported the US policewoman in exposing the sex trafficking network. In any case, it went to show that there's a peacekeeping economy going on here that's actually perpetuating the kinds of sexual and gender-based violence that went on during the war, and is perpetuated not by the Bosnians, not by the former Yugoslavs, but by the internationals. So it's true to say that, you know, most of Bosnia is considered a kind of a success case for the international community, and most of the world's attention has moved from Bosnia to so-called other conflicts and rape capitals. But I want to say that the situation for the estimated 30,000 war rape survivors and their families 2 decades after has hardly been addressed. So the numbers of these rapes has always been contentious, and I don't really want to go there. I think that it leads to a narrative about, you know, only if you have a certain scale of rape that somehow it deserves an intervention, and I think those arguments go both ways. Oh, there's too many, we can't address it, or there's not enough, so we're not going to, in terms of political, judicial, and military kinds of interventions. But regardless, in Bosnia there has not been sufficient convictions. It was only in 2015 that the first, that there was compensation through the criminal court, the National Criminal Court, there have been about 100 around 100 convictions through the International Tribunal for the Former Yugoslavia. So Bosnia represents for us the magnitude of the problem of impunity and the real limits to a prosecutorial approach to post-conflict justice. So with the Dayton Peace Accord and the Liberal Peace, the international community created the category of failed states. So partly when we start to hear about these. And failed states, my co-author Aida Hosic argues, who's also Bosnian, are sort of like 19th century fallen women who need to be rescued and rehabilitated to ensure the well-being of their neighbours and the broader community, in this case of states. And the solution implied by this kind of failed state notion is that once pacified, they need to be brought back into the family of democratic states. So the liberal piece, and I think, again, this is kind of a concept to interrogate because we forget that, it was only introduced in the 90s, is the assumption that the surest foundation for peace, both within states and between states, is market democracy. And that flourished in the 90s, and market democracy was seen as really the only model. It was the end of history, if you remember the Francis Fukuyama contribution. Now, peace building was also a concept introduced in the 90s as well. It was actually invented by Beatrice Gali, then UN Secretary General. And that notion of peace building is this idea that you need military force to go hand in hand with the building of liberal peace, with the opening of markets. So throughout the 1990s and into this century, internationals have championed free elections but preferred controlled election outcomes. So you don't get gender quotas. We know the story of Timor on that, but we can talk about it. They promoted economic reconstruction of war-torn societies but privatisation of state assets. They encouraged simultaneous state building and state shrinking and argued for the freedom of media but at the same time the suppression of dangerous voices. And work to strengthen civil society, but also to strengthen the state's repressive capacities in law and order. So highly contradictory. And at this time, if we can just imagine that date of peace accord image again with all the male political leaders there, a number of issues do not get addressed in peace, in the liberal peace. Women activists in Bosnia and Herzegovina argue today that many of the problems that have arisen since the war could have been avoided had there been more serious political engagement with women's civil society representatives and gender competent advisors. And these are some of the issues that Gorana Milinovic, who is an academic in Bosnia and also working with the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, argues. Issues like domestic violence, trafficking, healthcare, education, employment, are all have gender-related dimensions and should have been factored into a carefully planned transition in post-war Bosnia. Instead, issues that were recognised as serious and of ethno-national interest, such as education, or of particular importance for the political economy, such as employment and healthcare, they were used to consolidate ethno-nationalist and neoliberal positions. Jurisdiction over these issues had already been divided between the different ethno-nationalist elites at Dayton, without addressing any of the discriminatory or gendered aspects of these. So let me tell you a little bit about just how discriminatory some of those provisions were. So, in Bosnia, so the relief and recovery efforts and those that emanate from the Dayton Peace Accord almost entirely privileged war veterans over survivors of sexual gender-based violence and citizens who were victims of forced militarization. So, and as Wilf notes, the needs of women remain unreported, excluded. Men had exclusive control over and access to armies. That provided them with decision-making power. They were at the peace table, and they were able to decide on the political and economic setup of the state and the distribution of resources. So veterans get the lion's share. So let's have a look at what those, those reparations look like, those benefits look like. So the first thing to note is that more than 10% of the budget, in fact, in the Federation, 20% of the overall budget goes to veterans. Incredible. And less than 10% goes to other civilians. We can also see that it's an absolutely massive expense for the state. There are only 1,000 sexual gender-based violence victims who received means-tested social welfare financial compensation. And in that group, they're in the 30% of that group is in the poorest quartile. There would be no gender-sensitive reparations that could bring justice, or certainly to ensure political and economic participation. We're looking at this, and this is even somewhat dated data, we have to ask the question, how can we explain this kind of massive distributional inequality? The other thing to note is that the war veterans' payments are sort of, they're entitlements. And the other compensation through the social welfare system, that's actually means tested and that can actually be cut. So, and that has been cut. And as Madeleine Rees, the Secretary General of WILP, has said, you know, every time the welfare budget is cut, it's the survivors of violence, particularly women survivors of sexual violence, whose payments are slashed the most, let alone the challenges that they have in being able to prove their eligibility for these payments. And what Wilfords argues is that a reparations fund, which could be sourced from international lenders, from the UN Trust Fund for Victims of Violence, would actually remove this kind of drip feed approach, this dependency approach, which tends to perpetuate women's victimisation, and would also not depend on the conviction of a perpetrator, which has clearly not happened with 100 convictions and an estimated 250,000 rapes. So, let me turn now. I mean, I think, and interesting, as I pointed out, a common argument in Bosnia is that the large number, you know, the large number of victims is constantly used as an excuse for why the state could not possibly afford to reparate in this area. So, but what I really want to talk about 20 years later is this economic reform agenda and what this actually does to the situation of post-war reparation and lack of justice. So unlike security sector reform and disarmament, demobilisation and reintegration, post-conflict economic reform has not been on the women, peace and security agenda. So economic empowerment, again, is a sort of is one issue, and it's actually the theme in the United Nations Commission on the Status of Women going on right now in New York. But it's separated from peace and security. They're like two different policy agendas, and they're different UN agencies, different, you know, economic, and even in Australia, it's economic diplomacy and multilateralism versus kind of peace and security diplomacy. So, the siloing kind of effects, you know, and it disproportionately impacts women. So on two visits to Bosnia in 2015 and 2016, I learned a lot about this economic reform agenda, and I learned that the international agencies, including the European Union, the World Bank and the IMF, have a reform plan for Bosnia that will likely make the situation even worse for all victims of forced militarisation, and in particular for women survivors. So we know that the IMF plays historically a role in post-war recovery. After World War I, austerity and economic rationalisation was seen as the path to redemption. It wasn't a very successful path, as we know, but we think we've learned. But you know, there was also this push to cut public expenditure, especially social expenditure, to generate fresh taxation, privatisation, deregulation of labour. And credit after World War I to Germany was conditional on the restoration of order in the public finances. So it's the same narrative that we have in Bosnia and in the 21st century. So let me tell you a little bit about the Bosnian Economic Reform Plan. And it is underway, it is being implemented, it is successively being implemented. So the intention of this reform plan is to accelerate economic growth by liberalising the labour market and reducing the cost of labour, importantly by reducing the size of the public sector, shifting the social welfare system from universal to targeted coverage, privatising the health system, promoting foreign direct investment and infrastructure, especially those assets that can be easily sold off, like hydropower, telecommunications, roads, and investment, all investment in social infrastructure and development, such as through improvements in education, labour skills and training, health services and access to water and sanitation, these are all second order priorities in the reform plan, and these can only be addressed or considered for investment after measurable progress has been made on the first priorities of the economic reform package. And the IMF budgetary support loan to Bosnia that was agreed last year is all conditional on this progress. So a whole series of conditions. And none of these conditions were opened. They were part of a negotiation between the Bosnian government and the IMF, and none were opened to public debate or transparency until the letter was signed, sealed, and delivered. And here we have a really interesting TV debate in Bosnia last year when the Bosnian woman, Compere there, is asking the IMF economist, you know, what's in the deal, and he can't say anything. It's just a lovely, you know, non-event discussion where he's really out of his depth in that interview. However, we can learn other things about what was in the plan, and the letter is now public. It was published in September last year, the conditions of the loan, and it looks very much, it's very much what I listed on the previous page. So what's really interesting here, especially got Christine Lagarde this month at the UN talking about women, she was on the high-level panel for women's economic empowerment. In Bosnia, the IMF argues with this kind of reform plan that the winners will be the poor and often voiceless masses. This is their quote, the voiceless masses. And we may presume then both voiceless masses to include probably women and survivors of war atrocities. And the logic of the IMF plan and the World Bank development project is that women may win because with lower wages, there will actually be more jobs. And the infrastructure projects will also open up more economic opportunities. So that the lever, the driver here is foreign direct investment. And also that apparently the privatization of the health system will improve the quality of services, including for those who have significant health needs, continue to suffer trauma after war. Now, unfortunately, what we know from the rollout of austerity policies in other countries, and not even those that are post-conflict countries, is that actually women will be actually probably disproportionately the losers of this reform program. They'll be the beneficiaries of low-paid jobs and poorly paid jobs of a poor, profit-driven health system, which enables quality services for only those who can pay. And a trim public sector with less community services and social support, including early childhood education, where they're already closing down kindergartens, and less social support for the elderly as well, as well as a targeted system of social benefits that force people into the labour market, in particular, will require war widows and survivors to continually prove their eligibility requirements for welfare payments. So now, interestingly, the reform agenda is in part a response, and partly a response by the European Union, to a series of protests in Bosnia in 2014, which was called the Plenum Movement. And they were protests, it was a popular movement for participation and justice. And the EU has done here, together with the IFIs, is interpret this claim for justice as a need for economic reform. And they've focused on jobs, not on a constitution, not on a reworking of the Dayton Peace Accord. And the EU has at no point wanted to go public with the details of the loan agreement or the agenda, because they are very afraid that the whole political pact made at Dayton will unravel, and seeing that more in the context of the geopolitics of the Balkans. So the IMF loan, with a whole series of conditions, is effectively keep giving money to keep the ethno-nationalist neoliberal pact going. What I would say here is that this is the classic scandalous economics of post-conflict. So what's really interesting is that that reform agenda is utterly not adapted one little bit to the realities of a post-war society. And it's pretty much the same reform agenda that you saw rolled out across Eastern Europe after the collapse of communism. In this, in all of the reports by the IMF and the World Bank, there is a scandalous neglect of the fact that this is a society recovering from, not from the crisis of socialism or a planned economy, but from the crisis of ethno-nationalist war and divisions. There's a scandalous obfuscation of the distributional consequences of economic reform. There's no impact analysis. There's definitely no gendered impact analysis for different groups in society. And there's a scandalising reimagining of gender equality. Also, this notion that men and women can participate in the military and the labour market somehow in service of this society. And in fact, many people talk to in Bosnia said the military is basically the best place to work. Actually, you get these entitlement benefits as a veteran, you get all the services, and you get to be sort of participate in NATO activities. And so the big thing that the Bosnian government plays up in terms of gender equality is the fact that they've got women in the forces contributing to the NATO missions. And that's their implementation of the Women, Peace and Security agenda, the women soldiers. So a few things about the Bosnian economy that's really, to go backwards now on the reform plan. The Bosnian economy has barely recovered from the global financial crisis. So it basically was starting to recover before the global financial crisis, and it had 5.5% growth in 2008, and that basically went to negative growth. And it only just in 2015 did you actually start to see a plus sign there. But at the same time, it was the global financial crisis had a massive impact on remittances. And this is, I think, a huge issue for all post-conflict economies, is the massive dependence and reliance on remittances to prop up the state. So in Bosnia, before the global financial crisis, just have the figures here, in 2007 we had something like, so 20% of the GDP was based on remittances. And of course a lot of remittances are just cash, you know, cash given freely to, so they go under the radar, they don't get counted by the national statistics. So it's estimated it's much, much higher remittances. And so that dropped to about 15% after the global financial crisis. But what's really interesting about the remittance economy is that you can just see from that data there, six times larger than foreign direct investment, three times larger than overseas development assistance. It's about equivalent, even just on, in terms of the national statistics, the recorded remittances, it's the same as all social transfers, all healthcare and pensions, including the veterans payments. So it's massive. The economy is massively propped up by Bosnian, immigrants who are sending money back home. Now, what's really interesting is the IMF and World Bank think, wouldn't it be great if we could turn these remittances into entrepreneurial projects and we could regrow the economy? There's a problem with that ideology. That is that it's, and a really great paper from an economist at the University of Sarajevo showed that most of the remittances are going to support parents and family members and women in Bosnia to care for them. So this is the care economy. And this is the care economy that's picking up the slack of the state. And what we can see here is also that women, family members in particular, are kind of in a way forced into the care of family members who are, in large part still, have war-related injuries, trauma, and they are stepping in for members of the diaspora who can't provide those services because they're seeking their opportunity elsewhere, but they're also stepping in for the state, which is, retrenching its support services. And as a result, when we look at this economy here, we can see how the whole economic reform agenda totally underestimates not only the size of the remittance economy, but the size of the care economy and the gendered nature of that care economy. And the specific nature of a care economy in a post-conflict environment, where you literally have intergenerational harms and trauma, which continue to, which need to be continually recovered. That is part of the relief and the recovery. At the same time, you can sort of interpret this. You have massively high unemployment. 64% of young people are unemployed in Bosnia. This is one of the highest. This is the highest unemployment rate. Young people in all of Europe. Women's unemployment is 31%, significantly higher than men's at 25%, and you've got a decline in the population. You've got a decline in the birth rate, as well as you've got net immigration. So it's basically, it is a fragile state in the heart of Europe and in crisis. And you get the support reform agenda, supposedly trying to, generate growth through foreign investment. Okay. So, and what's really fascinating is that, you have a World Bank which says, well, the main problem in this economy is that there's a big gender gap in the labour market. And if only more women would work, the GDP could increase by, 16 to 20%, because that's a gender gap. And if we could recover that gender gap, women's labour market participation being the lowest in the OECD, we could restart the economy with no realisation or recognition of what the labour women are already doing in that quite massive remittance care economy. So no one asks, they don't ask, well, why is women's economic participation so low? It's not that they're doing nothing. There's no mapping of the care economy, the post-war care economy, and no mapping of the relief and recovery that's going on there. And it's really interesting to see the World Bank reports, because they're just a cookie-cutter reports that repeat the exact same things that they've done in every other country. Countries that are not conflict affected, where they say, well, the biggest problem with women's participation is domestic violence. Women are suffering from domestic violence, they can't get to work, And yet this is a country where domestic violence, maybe it is an issue, but it is certainly only one type of violence that their country is suffering from. Okay. So this is a Bosnian graffiti artist who wrote No More Peace. We've had enough peace. Unfortunately, the realities about the care economy and the remittance economy are really inconvenient, not only to the IFI's reform agenda, but also to the ethno-nationalist elites who have made that kind of impact. I think just to note that Bosnia has the highest number of conditionalities on the loan of any country in the world at present. There's also the same with Ukraine. So it's quite interesting. So a lot of the conditions are related to the kinds of reforms that were perhaps carried out in Eastern Europe in the 1990s as well. So where does this leave women's post-conflict participation? Well, we can expect the Bosnian economic reform agenda to exacerbate the conditions for gendered violence and even the conditions for the recurrence of conflict, because it's going to likely increase many of the direct and indirect factors, risk factors for that violence. Unequal power, financial stress, economic instability, unemployment, lack of services, men's risky behaviours such as alcoholism, drug taking and suicide. All of these are key risk factors, you know, in the epidemiological research around not only gender-based violence but also conflict. And so ironically, a plan which is intended to bring prosperity to Bosnia in 1 to 2 generations will likely undermine rather than empower women to participate in the post-conflict sphere. As intended by Security Council 1325. And it's worth remembering, you know, how were conflicts ignited in the first place in the former Yugoslavia, as well as Ukraine, Cyprus, and Iraq. And I would argue that all of these conflicts were ignited by unequal and uneven development. And that the reactions to unequal and uneven development played out in highly gendered and sexualized ways, particularly on women's bodies, to provoke international attention, but while also often contesting hegemonic capitalist norms and powers of the West. So post-conflict and post-global financial crisis recovery in Bosnia through economic reform is reinforcing inequality. It's prompting also the acceptance of a continuum of structural and gendered violence and increasingly militarised worldwide order. One of the ways Bosnia props up its economy, which again goes under the radar of national statistics, anybody guess one other way they might make money? Oh, they sell arms. Mm-hmm. Guess where they sell arms to? Syria. Well, so they have, like, I mean, some scholars have been tracking the flight out of Sarajevo and also other parts of former Yugoslavia and where those flights go and what those flights contain. And that way are able to see basically the illegal arms trade that's also going on to pop them up. So there's more to the underground economy than I've spoken about today. But in any case, in Bosnia, there is a huge risk of a production of a narrative of negative peace that does not address structural inequalities and gender dynamics, that marginalises women, motivates men to fight, and a post-conflict state that's doomed to repeat rather than reconcile the past. And I think here, you have an example of even militarisation and even a peace which is, propped up by highly militarised, Western powers cannot bring the commodity fiction of the free individual and the free market into being. So I think Bosnia disproves the social rupture theory, that there's a huge opportunity in post-conflict to reinvent, unfortunately, social relations. And I think it also really highlights the significance and the need to take into account post-conflict economic reform, not only to look at the political sphere and the delivery of legal justice, but to look at the economic arrangements and the impacts of austerity and reform on female-headed households in particular, which is often a group that is particularly affected after conflict. So at the moment, internationally, we have a whole focus, part of the focus on sexual violence in conflict has been eclipsed by this interest in women's participation in peace processes. I don't know if any of you have heard this. Obviously, it's very pertinent to my research and my area of research, with this notion that peace processes should be inclusive, that they should reflect the range of groups, and especially non-armed groups and women. But of course, what I would argue is that is actually not going to deliver justice or prevent violence unless those women or some of those groups at the peace table are able to bring a gender-sensitive, gender-just economic agenda to the table. So I'll leave it there and happy to take your questions.
Thank you so much. We're open for questions. I think questions only, no comments at this stage, because we're going to have a huge amount of time. And you could just, as a courtesy to Jacqui, identify yourself very briefly. They're the only preconditions for putting your hand up. Say if you had a question.
Thanks, Gary. So first of all, before I, threw my questions to... I'm Said Abdullah from the ACSS Center. So my research is, I think, is linked to the what Jacqui threw in the frame here. But before that, I would just like to ACSS Research Center because it's the first time, during my PhD, I attended gender seminar here because I think it's long time, we never had a topic like this. Then second thing that they mentions by Jacqui Truth is it's a very wonderful presentation and also linked to my research project in post-conflict of Aceh. So I think we already met and discussed
Osses
conference. But it's interesting because in this presentation you mentions about the very big pictures on how women be inside line in the post-conflict situations. But you already addressed it in your research, but it didn't come up here in the presentation. How the ideology of militarism? You said you mentioned several times about militarization, but here more socio-economic picture, structure that impact the women visibility in post-conflict situations, but. How about the idea of militarism? How local, the power dynamic in Bosnia impact to the, women? I think the problem is not the women, but the problem is men with a masculinity stuff like that. Maybe Professor Chu can expand in this area. Thanks.
Take a few. Kelly.
What you've outlined, I guess, is the exacerbation of similar trends we see elsewhere in terms of economic empowerment being understood as jobs and the continuing marginalisation and kind of counting and denial of reproductive labour. And that, I guess, is one aspect of what you were talking about. And so we know very much that representation, I guess, is not the answer to the question because it very much depends on how women participate in these sorts of negotiations post-conflict. I'm wondering what your thoughts are on how you would look to transform the international power brokers that are negotiating the post-conflict context. So what are kind of the inroads for looking at how international power brokers then enter into these kinds of contexts?
Sorry, Ben. Ben Riley. Thanks, Jacqui. Just on social rupture, the theory, I wonder if Bosnia really is the best case for actually assessing that. And I'll tell you why. One of the really distinctive things about the Bosnian peace process, more than any other that I'm aware of, is that it sought to freeze the ethnic issue in place. You have this tripartite presidency, you actually have parallel government departments, departments of education, and lots of other areas that you'd be well aware of. So it's kind of difficult in a way, I think, in an environment where the peace process was about freezing rather than transforming the conflict. So I think, East Timor or one of these other cases, actually might, where there was more room for change, because you know there wasn't that kind of very explicit intervention, might be better. So maybe just your response to that.
Thanks,
Ben.
Let's deal with those and see how much time we have.
Thanks so much for your questions. Nice to see you again, Saeed, and thank you for that. Yeah, I mean, I obviously played up sort of political economy dimensions, and I think the ideology of militarism is very significant in the context of Bosnia and Herzegovina, where you have, you know, this kind of separation of ethno-nationalist groups, and in fact, which contributes to recreating, and actually not just to freezing, but actually, you know, elevating ethno-nationalist identity. And I think that, you know, but I think that the key political economy of dimension here is this fact of the entitlements to veterans. And there's actually many IMF conditions on this, because they've actually tried to cut into this, right? But there's, so, you know, there's such a protected part of the state, and it's so linked to the political pact, that they're sort of untouchable, and of course that just reproduces the militarism, because, you know, and when people say, well, the military is great, it's like a functioning part of our society, I mean, what does that do? You know, the best that we can do in Bosnia is to export our arms, you know, illegally, the ones that we've, you know, got left over, and to participate in NATO missions. So, of course, that is recycling. And then when it comes in the form of sort of also being part of those patronage networks linked to the ethno-nationalist groups, you know, that's the grounds to, you know, have the foundations for, you know, the recurrence of conflict during any time, especially when there are, you know, some significant conflicts cannot be addressed by the, kind of the political institutions that have been set up under the Dayton Peace Accord. So the military is the privileged institution, the veterans are the privileged citizens. I didn't sort of mention when I said about the veterans, but it also, these payments, they don't just freeze, they shift, they redistribute, because something like 75% of all the payments to veterans are going to those in the top two quintile, and then 75% of that is to the top. So it's actually distributing to the rich. And then, you know, the payments to the civilian victims are going, the majority of them, to the bottom quintile. So there's actually also a redistribution happening there, which is actually, you know, further supporting those who link their well-being and welfare and future to the military. So that is actually, you know, and then it's supported by militarism and military ideologies throughout the society. So I think, you know, I think it's important to see how they work together. This is a great question. Thank you, Kelly, and nice to meet you. I've been working on this question about what are the entry points to bring in a more gender sensitive economic agenda into these kind of conflict environments. What would we do now if we had an opportunity to do data over again? And I think that this is very much the push of the women's peace movement that I'm really involved with, Wilf, and have been doing solidarity dialogues between women in Ukraine, Syria, Bosnia. You know, literally, like, what are the things that we need to analyse? I think for the start, donor countries need to require, at a minimum, a proper gender impact assessment audit of any kind of economic reform. And this needs to be done, actually, you know, during, at the same time, as part of this process. Because these plans are already, you know, already together and happening, and often not even negotiated. And I think that there need to be, I mean, this kind of the analysis done with respect to reparations, there needs to be some real thought to collective reparations and some thought of actually, you know, one-off cash payments that can actually be linked to significant investments in social infrastructure and care infrastructure and into women's economic opportunities. I think there's lots of things to be done. And I'm really working actively on that at the moment, and that's what the interviews are. But I would say that this is not on anybody's agenda exactly, because if we look at the high-level panel on women's economic empowerment in 2016, and there are various reports and working papers that have brought out, I mean, I think, just to give you an example, the flagship report, it was like over 150 pages, had one box on fragile and conflict-affected So people are not, and then the World Bank is doing has an updated gender strategy, and they are doing some things, but they're not actually really targeting these types of countries, and they're not piloting initiatives to really address these significant inequalities, which are likely to be compounded. So I think there is lots that can be done, and I think there are some key power brokers. Donor states, for example, who would be willing to bring this to the agenda. I think it's much more challenging when you're talking about conflict armed parties to these peace agreements and how you would. I think that a political economy approach that's critical doesn't mean that we don't think that economic incentives can play a role. I think they can, but we need to acknowledge the redistribution that's going on already. Post-conflict countries, and actually be aware in the ways that it is actually redistributing power, more power to certain groups of men. Ben, thanks for your question. Well, from a social science perspective, maybe Bosnia isn't the best case for social rupture, and there, and it's not to say that it couldn't exist in other contexts. However, I think that a lot of the literature on liberal peace and peace building is hung on the case of Bosnia, and so it's significant in that regard to unpack what that looks like and what that continues to look like. As I've kind of answered in relation to other people's questions, I think even in a situation where you thought you were freezing it, you're actually not freezing it, you're actually recreating the conditions for future conflict. And I haven't talked about it in all the range of areas, and I certainly didn't go into depth about the ethno-nationalist institutions, but even to think about the case of where you have a whole education system with totally different narratives of society being created in the post-conflict era. It's just insane. And you might have heard about the schools under one roof where they have totally different curriculum. They all go to the same school, and they apparently learn different languages and different stories about the war. There's systematic problems with the way in which that piece was made, and it's not over when it's over, I guess. But I think there are some kind of interesting comparisons and contrasts with a country like Sri Lanka, where there is a lot of political will to, make that country an economic powerhouse, middle income. Success case for Asia, and there is a recognition already that the Sri Lankan economy is quite significantly reliant, especially in the export-oriented areas, on women's labour, and the importance of addressing, for example, violence against women, because that's a big barrier to women's participation in the labour market, and the economy literally is not going to grow, or is not going to have the human capacity to grow without harnessing that labour. But at the same time, it has, really systemic impunity for the violence, the human rights violations, and the marginalisation of ethnic minority women during the war. So it's kind of an interesting contrast to Bosnia, because they don't talk about sexual violence in Sri Lanka. It's embarrassing. They just don't want to talk about it. They talk about it only in Bosnia, but we can't get onto the conversation about economic recovery. In Sri Lanka, all they want to talk about is economic empowerment, but they're not addressing some of the underlying significant barriers to that. I use the social rupture less as a kind of testing hypothesis testing thing than let's take this as something. Let's take post-conflict as an opportunity. And actually look at what that, look at how that opportunity is played out in a range of different but significant conflict settings in terms of the international efforts.
I have two questions. I'll take time. So Jane Hutchison, Asia Research Centre of Politics, and Sam likewise, Sam McKinder likewise. So Jane first, then Sam.
Yeah, thanks, Jacqui. I was really just wanting to pick up the point you were making in response to Syed. in your presentation, you emphasised in political economy terms very much the neoliberal agenda being imposed on Bosnia. But then in your response to Saif, you were pointing out the domestic political economy dynamics that were having a quite a profound impact. So whilst that doesn't challenge at all or change at all your essential gender analysis, I thought that in many ways it's probably a more interesting dynamic going on there, and that these neoliberal agendas, I mean, one thing about working in Southeast Asia, and I do work in the area of development effectiveness, and looking at, in fact, the how limited international organisations, their capacities are to transform societies in terms of those domestic political economies. So to what extent is your analysis including some of that domestic political economy analysis, which in fact counteracts some of those agendas that are being posed internationally?
Thanks, Jacqui. Which your question now?
Yeah, okay, great question. I enjoyed your presentation, Jacqui. The issues you are raising touch on what I would describe as a global structural problem, in the sense that the world is not willing to discuss how to train political leaders. When they go to a place to establish peace, scholars like us would say, well, it's going to be a transformative process. But peace in the minds of policymakers is not a transformative process. It's a question of whether they can have elections and people vote or whatnot there. And they want to cut the budget as much as possible so that they even approve that peace has been established because they want to cut the budget without taking that that's the case. Now, the people who take over as leaders have never been trained. If we want a lawyer, we go for somebody who has a certificate in law. If we want an engineer, the same, doctor, the same thing. But with politicians, just get anybody to be a political leader. So how do you expect these people to transform the process when we have not actually tested whether they have the capacity to do so or not? And the world is not willing to do that. I've been looking at the situation in South Sudan, and the situation is terrible. It's very worse for women. Worse for women in the sense that there's no national army. The armies are, well, the soldiers belong to leaders, to warlords, who loan their people to a particular leader. They can change their minds and loan their soldiers to the opposition leader or the president. And many of these people control their soldiers because they have even given them wives. Their daughters have been married to these people as a present. I mean, that's how women are abusing that system. I've been writing an article on this situation, suggesting that Sudan went to independence before it was ready to do so, and that perhaps we should have some kind of co-governance where the United Nations is involved, the African Union is involved, and the South Sudanese people are involved. This article has been rejected by six journals, including the top journalist in Australia, because this is very patronizing for people. So we have a structural problem here that we have leaders who are not trained to lead, and you cannot expect a transformative process coming out of people who have no idea what transformation is.
Thanks, Jacqui, for your wonderful presentation. I'm Kazi. I'm doing a PhD here with Kanishkan Jain, and I'm working on NGOs and plasma. I think at one point of your presentation, you say that during the peace negotiation, I mean, there was not enough involvement of the women's organizations. My question is, I mean, are those women's organizations necessarily like women's NGOs? Because, I mean, my experience in case of Bangladesh and several other countries, I think, you often have these NGOs more like backing up the neoliberal agenda than like opposing it. So I'm not sure, I mean, if there were more like women's, so, I mean, as such women's organizations involved in the peace process, you would have more like women's issues and women's economic justice issues represented in the peace agenda.
Okay,
I'll
see that later. Thanks so much for, you've got one too?
No, this will be
okay. Thanks so much for your questions. They're really, really provocative. Jane, I mean, I think I have really underplayed the domestic political economy story here, it's true. But I guess I wanted to also emphasize that there is a pact between ethno-nationalist elites and the neoliberal international financial institutions. So they are propping one another up. You know, and there's certain things that, like, that's why, you know, they're actually quite happy to not have investment in social infrastructure and education, because education is something that's totally split according to the three ethno-nationalist groups. So that's not going to be something in the plan. They don't care. Even though, like, from a perspective around, you know, human development and recovery, that would seem to be a pretty important peace-building aspect of, you know, of an economic reform agenda. And the same goes for, you know, the kind of veterans benefits. I mean, there's certain accommodation made there. That's the main thing they want to really protect, but not to the extent that they're going to kind of lose those benefits. So it's a negotiation, and it's a pact, absolutely. And it's not to say that, you know, what's going on in the Bosnian economy is completely unsustainable. You know, you can't have 20% of your budget going to those kinds of entitlements, obviously. But the debate about, you know, that in 2014 when you had this citizens movement quite widespread and really wanting to have a discussion not simply about economic reform but about a constitution, you know, that is suppressed by simply, you know, a sense that it's all about solving the problem of unemployment. You know, something that also the ethno-nationalist elites bought into. And I guess the challenge, you know, politically is that, you know, it's very difficult for other groups or identities to be represented in such a system, to have a voice, and to even have an opportunity to forge that voice. And that makes it extremely difficult for women because, you know, it's, you know, then, you know, you have to, you know, gain that voice within those ethno-nationalist political parties. And I think even in Bosnia recently, they changed the electoral reform law so that, you know, the threshold was much higher for small parties, so that you couldn't even mount a new political party to kind of contest power. So no, what we can see in that reform is definitely something that's owned by the Bosnian government. But the Bosnian government has absolutely, you know, because of its ties to the, you know, the patronage networks that are linked to those ethno-nationalist groups, has limited any broader kind of public participation about what kind of economic reform, you know, what kind of future. But that isn't to say that international financial institutions and donor countries don't play, and the European Union in particular, given that country has been, you know, hanging on the promise of becoming an EU member forever, does not have a number of levers within that country and a significant responsibility. I think that that's actually quite different from Asia in that sense. I really like your thoughts, Sam, and I think this is a big issue. I mean, I did my PhD on transformation from communism and really looked closely at Czechoslovakia and, of course, the dissident movements there, and who really, you know, were architects of the Velvet Revolution, but actually had no real idea about how to transition the polity and the economy, and therefore, you know, very, very quickly lost power to those grey zone technocrats who, you know, were much more savvy and linked to international financial institutions and others who did have plans. So I think that a key issue for the future is that if you want to make peace, then you need to invest in you do need to invest in political leaders and social movements. And not simply in, you know, in what that society, you know, how that society would look, and what kinds of reforms and plans would need to be put in place after the end of the conflict or bringing to peace. So I mean, I think you can see some of this learning happening, and that's kind of part of the initiative I think you see now in the Women, Peace and Security agenda is also, yes, there's a big push for literally women's bodies at the peace table, as if that will generate any kind of inclusion or justice for all groups. But with that, I think now, you know, this idea, and certainly you can see it with Sweden's support to the Syrian opposition and the women in the opposition, is actually, you know, what kinds of skills and knowledge and capacities do you need actually to govern a society once, you know, once there is some kind of ceasefire, truce, you know, peace, negative peace. And I sort of quite provocatively talked about, and I think it's probably somewhere on the internet, that you know, if we think about the model of the Marshall Plan after World War II, which brought civil servants from Germany and Japan to the United States, and which is also about, you know, giving them the skills and capacities to transform the, you know, their governments and their public sectors, which are also, you know, levers for the private sector, that was a massive investment, and a massive investment in human capacity and political leadership, ultimately, in those societies. In those societies, which then became democracies, right? So why are we not thinking about Marshall Plans for Syria? Significant, all those immigrants and migrants sitting in Europe who could be being trained and in leadership and a whole lot of different areas of leadership in different sectors of the economy and society, and ready to go back when there is some kind of peace. To be those who can transform their society. And what's that?
I support that.
Well, I think that, you know, this is definitely, I've kind of been saying it with also, so it's a little bit advocacy side of the research, but I mean, I've done a number of, NGOs and others are really on this track, and I think that that's what we need to be doing, and certainly Wilt and Kvinna till Kvinna, which is the largest women's rights NGO in Sweden, significantly funded by the Swedish government, which now has an official feminist foreign policy, that is their mission, to have solidarity dialogues across these countries, to take the learning and to build the capacities of women political leaders who can, you know, help to transform those societies. And that's a kind of capacity that we have not sufficiently invested in or realised. And the last question, gosh, over here, I'm forgetting your name.
Kazi,
thank you. I think it's really related to Sam's point also, which is, you know, and of course NGOs are not social movements in themselves, are they? And it's also this question of which women at the peace table, who do they represent? Yeah. And, you know, kind of what's happening, and what's happening in Syria is that you also, you know, you have token women who reflect the same interests and perspectives of the armed groups, and that is not transformative in any sense. So, you know, we can't just focus on sex. We need to focus on the kind of perspective, the gender perspective that particular women might bring, and they're only going to bring it if they've been part of a broader social movement that has generated and learned from the experiences of other countries, but also generated a perspective that reflects the experiences of conflict that they have and the concerns that they have for the future of their society. So it's not, there's no easy answers, and it is what I'm saying, it is quite future oriented, but I think that you can see things are moving quite fast now, and in a country like Myanmar, which has a peace process and there's a significant investment from the international community for now, including the Australian government, to actually build up the capacities of women leaders across a range of ethnic groups to participate in that peace process, and to actually give them a sense of what would be the substantive agenda they would actually bring to the table. That is quite significant. And I don't know if you're aware of, I mean, it's not peer-reviewed research, but it's certainly research that I've been involved in and that has been strongly disseminated by the United Nations, is this notion that, you know, like when we have observed the 43 cases of peace agreements, we see that when women do participate in those in some form, not necessarily in the formal peace agreement signing and so on, but also in national dialogues and protest and consultations, That those peace agreements are much more likely to be signed, and they're much more, you know, they're something like 30% more likely to be sustained over 5 years. So that we have some tentative evidence that suggests that, you know, even without a substantive agenda, it does actually matter to have, you know, more gender inclusive peace processes. And now I think the next piece is to say, okay, well, how can inclusive peace processes actually deliver a more inclusive post-conflict, transformative society?
We're going to have to wrap it up, unfortunately. It's time for our lunches and Jacqui's dinner. She's on a 3-hour time difference, and she's only just recently come back from the United States and made a big adjustment to her body clock, which is another reason for being really grateful that she's made the time to come over and speak to us today, which I'm sure we all greatly appreciate, and it was a fantastic presentation. Thanks very much, Jacqui.